All right, guys. Welcome back to the channel. I'm glad you're here. I'm Jimmy. We're making it work if you're new. We're starting a day in the shop. Ought to be pretty interesting. We already got, don't lie, in the parking lot, Ford, Chrysler, BMW, all towed in. Let's do it. Stay tuned. Oh, Florida sunshine. Wait a second. Whoa. All right, allegedly, we're gonna try to do the evaporator on the Highlander now. Let's see what happens. We got the air box out. If you guys have done these old Toyotas, the hard parts, these are all labeled, but not breaking things. They're really brittle. The air inlet hose gets real brittle, but this one was all right. I think because it's garage kept. I'm gonna disconnect the battery now. That way I can leave the doors open and not kill the battery, and disable the airbag system at the same time. It takes about 2 or 3 minutes to discharge the capacitors that store voltage in the airbag modules. So you want to wait a few minutes before you go pulling horn pads off and stuff like that. This just kick pound just pops off a couple of clips, 2 10 millimeter bolt. A little bit of a pain in the poop deck to get this hood release cable out. 2 snaps holding the AOBL connector. The camera wasn't charged for me to get that for you. Pretty quick and easy though. You gotta take the center console out. Couple 8 millimeter screws, a couple 10s in the glove box. These panels all pop off. This has to come off. You gotta strip the entire dash, drop the steering column, take the plastic cover off, then take the metal brace off, then you can get the HVAC box. It's like 6 hours, 6.4 hours of labor or something like that. And I think it's gonna probably take every bit of it. I tend to do interior work slow. I actually like it, a lot of people hate it. I don't mind it, because you can kind of, you know, you got to stay clean because you're messing with fabric and stuff like that, but they tend to leave you alone when you're doing a big job. Oh, professional blower's going again. We'll come back. I got to get the shifter lever back so I can get the console cover off. Hook the battery up momentarily so I can get the shifter back. And I got to go unhook the battery again. Pocket screwdrivers aren't recommended, but sometimes the plastic tools won't get it started, so you do what you gotta do, you know?
You got a 10?
I gotta take a look, I probably do. Come on now. Ooh, they're tight. That's why when they get old, they break. Luckily, this car's kept indoors, so it's not, plastic's not as brittle. It's still brittle, just not as brittle. Man, that's sketchy. Worst case scenario, something cracks, then you're talking about gluing it back together and refinishing it or something, but or just making them order a new one, because when we're working on this stuff, we're not breaking things on purpose. If you're careful and it breaks, that's what happens. That's the nature of the beast. 20-year-old vehicles, you do the best you can, and hopefully it goes smooth and you're rowing fast enough. We got Audi, we got Dodge, we got Ford, we got a Fiat coming in. We got the mobile mechanic caravan we haven't looked at yet, but and we got broken Toyota. See, they all break. Get back here. Put this, I'm using the rear hatch area to keep all the plastic in so it's safe. This is the only power going to this console. On modern vehicles, there's like a 16 wire connector on there because there's all kinds of electronics on the console going to the rear. But I think on this one, that's all it is. Should be able to lift this thing out of here now. I see why they talk about taking the armrests off. It looks like you might not be able to fit this out otherwise. Unless you're real tricky. And I'm pretty tricky. Uh-oh. Not happening. That makes me a little sad. I'm going to take an armrest off. Well, that's kind of cool. Just folded the seat back instead. These pins should slide out of here. The phone's ringing. Katie's out with COVID, so you may hear the phones ringing several times. She didn't feel well last Tuesday, and she felt worse Wednesday, and she passed 2 COVID tests. They both came back negative. And then the next day she was even sicker, and the day after that she was really sick. And then she got a positive. Once she was positive she had it, the test was positive. When she wasn't sure, the test was negative. So, just FYI. She was at work those days too. It's a supposedly you can catch it multiple times, so. Oh, that's not good. Got to disconnect my little hydraulic glove box thingamabob. There you go. One thingamabob. Discombobulated. Plastic nut on top of the kick panel kept me from getting it off. These just have little legs that pop into these slots, so you got to kind of get this out of the way. Then you can kind of put it back a little bit. This bolt's got to come out, so I'm not putting it back in front of it. It says to take the steering column out. You got to completely disassemble it. Steering wheel, airbag, covers, everything, but it might be true. But I'm going to try it without taking the steering wheel off by turning the wheel to get to the Phillips screws that are hidden underneath it. You guys see that up here? There's a Phillips screw on each side. And I think that's the only reason they want you to take the steering wheel and airbag off. So I'm going to try without that. But I do have to take the kick panel out of the way. These have little hooks that they hang on. So, I don't... Oh, professional air blower again. And that's all right. Someone was asking me how I like these Vessel screwdrivers. Best screwdrivers I've ever owned. Not to mention the JIS tips work better than Japanese screws. We call them Phillips, but they're slightly different. And this has like serrated teeth on the tip, so it bites real good. And it's full tang, so you can hammer it if you need to impact a screw that's stuck a little in some metal or whatever. But great screwdrivers. I think I paid like $88 for them, but I'm sure they've gone way up right now. And he thinks it's discombobulated enough to come apart. We get a few electrical connectors in here. Airbag one's a little odd. This one is a flip lever, I think. Nope, it's got a little push tab that you can't see. Now we're getting somewhere. A couple more electrical connectors to go. All right. Yeah, that was hardly worth having a steering column my way the whole time. It was not even 5 minutes. So the 12 down on the steering column, I'm gonna mark the column and the rack so I can at least get within a spline. and then I think there's four 12s holding the column in, I can get it completely out of my way.
Those are hidden. Ah. Probably shouldn't use a little quarter drive for that, but it seems to be working fine.
That's how you know it's out. Now it's only held on by the splined end, which I use my paint marker pen, and it's not really working good. It's brand new, and I can't get any yellow out of it. Just barely put a yellow mark on it, but I did put the steering wheel straight ahead, and the tires are straight ahead. But these are so fine splined, just the littlest bit, the steering wheel is off center, so you can either do an alignment at that point, or slide it back apart and recenter it. Come on off of there. I got the bolt out. I have to get a little hammer action going. I wonder what the phone is ringing. I'm really gonna wanna try to get that back on centered. It doesn't come apart as easy as I remember. Thanks, Louise. That's where the term Geez Louise comes from. There's gonna be a lot of loose electrical connectors. Unlike some vehicles I've worked on, it doesn't look like any two are the same yet. I remember one time a few years ago, a friend of mine, Eddie, he plugged in two electrical connectors on a Silverado truck behind the glove box. He plugged them in different. They were the same exact connector next to each other. He plugged them in wrong. When you turn the turn signal on, it would beep the horn and weird stuff like that. I forget all the exact symptoms, but it was funny as hell. Until we both figured out what happened, I told him there had to be a connector that's the same. And then he remembered those two behind the glove box.
only took us about 20 minutes to figure that one out, but that's no fun. It's like an erector set. I broke that. I blew it.
All right, that's about it. That's fixed. Just gotta put my little yellow clip back on it. Good as new. Little plastic weld action. I'll be a little bit ginger putting it back on. Boom. Oh, that's nice.
This is one of those things, even though I kind of like Toyota, but this screw here, is there's one screw at the top, two at the bottom. So you can't get to the one screw here without taking four screws out here to get this decorative panel out of the way. I don't know. I just got to point out the things I don't like about every brand. Sometimes they do things that don't make sense to a mechanic. But, you know, for the engineers, that's their best solution. So, I mean, I kind of understand it, but you can still wish things were a little better, right? Nothing wrong with that. Now I can get to this screw. Just can't quite push them all the way by hand. Put this in a safe place. I always like to wipe the dust off this too when I put it back together. Just the customer won't know why, but it'll look real nice. Well, I wanted to say too, if you do wipe that cluster panel down, don't use a shop rag. You gotta treat it like a painted surface because that plastic's real delicate. If you go buffing on it with a shop rag, then it's gonna have a haze to it. So that's the opposite. Better off not cleaning it at all. Use a good detailing lint-free towel and some glass cleaner. These are all 10 millimeter bolts. All right, this could get a little sketchy. Lots of connectors. And they all look like they'll be different. You just gotta remember where to feed them through the dash when you're putting things back together. Maybe I'll play some music during this part. It's not too exciting. Uh-oh, there's something else on it. Oh, no, just a shifter. Okay, we're getting somewhere now. About an hour and in. New tool. Check her out. These Toyota line locks, these plastic tab locks. It's a special tool to release them. Most people just break them open and then try to get them to stay closed when they're done, but it's the only thing holds the lines together. Without those on there, the line slides right off. So, well, you can wiggle it off, it doesn't slide off. But anyway, so I bought me this tool because Dale had it on the gear wrench truck. Guess how much? You guys, it's a piece of aluminum, it doesn't weigh much, and it's got two metal pins up here for pushing in that tool. See the taper on them? For releasing that lock. You guys tell me in the comments how much you think that was. Interesting.
Fine German automobile with a melted shock.
That's really strange. Something caught on fire
and melted the shock. I smell oil or fluid film or something on this thing. Maybe that's shock oil that came out of it when it got hot. What do you guys think? Very strange. Maybe the Joe's working on this one. He wanted me to take a look and see what I thought, but something melted the shock, or the shock melted something. Very strange. We're trying to figure out if it's the brakes locking up that made this get hot, but Joe's got a good theory that shock speed made the shock overheat because the tire is so bad. You see that tire? That is no bueno. So probably what happened is the guy was going down the highway about 70 or 100 or whatever BMW drivers do, and that shock was going so fast up and down, he just kept going and it melted the shock. The shock probably had to get glowing hot because this is all melted, and then shock oil blew out everywhere. So that's what happened. This tire is so bad, and the customer just kept driving it the way it is. I wonder if the tire could have got hot and that happened as well. But the tire probably, oh, look at it, it's dry rotted and separating. And yeah, that's bad. That's just someone drove the hell out of it with a bad tire. Put some labels on my wires just because I don't do a lot of these Toyotas and I do so many different brands, it's hard to remember. So I labeled the wires: radio, shifter, headlights, so I have a good idea when this goes back in what holes things need to come through. We're about ready to lift this dash out now, I think. Let's do it. There's always a couple connectors you gotta get. All right, I had to dig in and get these three connectors here. This one's interesting. The connector lock tab is inside here. So I pulled it off this metal bracket to disconnect it and put it back on so I remember where it went. But those wires should be pretty self-explanatory.
Let's see what happens now. Oh, that's better. Got an antenna to discombobulate. I didn't even think of that. Oh my goodness. This will dig into your knee if you're now the antenna's off. Now it's coming out. Sorry, Jesus. Bumped into him. I'll pull the carpet back, pop that duct out of there, and then you can get to those two bottom bolts. So you can lay this out of the way. I might have to take this one off too, I'm not sure. But I'm gonna try it without it. We'll see what happens. I'm hoping I can slide the case back enough and roll it out. I might have to take that duct off and loosen those. Three bolts on the side, two bolts up here. I gotta do the side. There's two bolts on that side. You don't take the whole bracket off. They got two little bolts. This 14 is the only one that's the real heavy duty. Other way, it goes to the brake pedal bracket. So I guess they want it extra sturdy. It's gonna have to pull out this way so it'll slide off the studs over here. Yeah, I'm probably gonna have to loosen that if I could. Braces out. Get back here. All right, heater hose is disconnected. Got me a little drain pan down there on the floor. So, I'm gonna probably blow a little shop air in the top one just to try to get extra antifreeze out of the heater core so it doesn't spill in the car. Now I gotta use my sweet new tool to get these couplers off. Then, we're pretty close to pulling this thing out. That won't come off easy. And we'll see how easy this one comes off. Oh, it's so much better when you have the right tool. Just that I think it should be about $15 instead of $45. But Dale had it on the truck, so I get it from him instead of Amazon, and I have it for the job today. Works out all right. Might be some residual pressure in here. I vacuumed it down Friday. Now it says not to put tools in there. Sometimes they come apart, sometimes they don't. Try a little shot of this. There you go. Alright. That's better. Whoa, you guys fell. You were right? Sorry about that. Better make for you guys to fall down. Jesus Christmas. Now that's just abuse. That's viewer abuse. Especially my subscribers. I really apologize to all my subscribers. If you haven't subscribed yet, I'll apologize to you right after you subscribe. Speaking of subscribers, my buddy Dudes with Wrenches. Man, his channel's taken off from 700 subscribers to 36,000 in a couple weeks. That's impressive. He made some good shorts and it's working for him. I think it's pretty good. I got 80% of the antifreeze out of there. I'll still try not to tilt it and spill antifreeze. The car's got a really clean interior. I've been trying to keep my tools in this, where the center console goes, so I don't make a mess on the carpet and stuff. It's got rubber mats though. I'm gonna wipe them down when I'm done. It's got a combination of bolts, clips, there's a screw from the bottom, just to make it interesting. You gotta take the blower assembly out so you can get the HVAC assembly out. Oh, you guys want some light? Alright. Want a little light? I'll give you some light. What's the power on? Oh, there's a wire over here. One more actuator connector. And one clip. Don't worry, I let it most of that out. Especially the cursing and screaming. I did get a cut. Get a little cut on the old finger. Bring it over to the workbench. I'm gonna try to reuse that stuff. Insulated rubber, a couple of Allens, and you gotta scoop the whole case in half. I told you I drop my Milwaukee tools all the time. Now, I gotta flip the case around and take all the screws out. I think it's about 11 screws, it said. Why, but it says take this off.
got the 1-800 radiator evaporator core, which makes me a little bit sad, but they're hit or miss. The radiator's a hit or miss. I've gotten some good ones and some bad ones. Uh-oh. That's terrible. Well, looks good. Comes with the foam. That's good. The original foam didn't look like it was going to make it. Only the bottom piece came off. And that'll fit right on there. Oop. Gravity checked it and caught it with my feet, so it didn't take the hit. This should be the expansion valve. I love opening boxes. It's like Christmas. Sometimes they steal my joy up front and they'll open them for me because they want to look at them too. I'm like, what'd you look at? You don't know what the old part looks like yet. Anyway, this looks good. The only conundrum is going to be getting these doors lined back up because I think I took it apart wrong, but we'll see. I got them facing in the direction of all the pins. So if it fights me, I'm going to have to try something else. We'll see what happens. You're putting this stuff back in before you got a full belly. Although I try to eat kind of light at lunch, but some days that plan goes awry. For some of you younger guys, awry means goes out of order. Come on, be serious. Be honest. Did you know what awry meant? Because I never used it. Never used a kit. A lot of random screws. Actuator. Evaporator temperature sensor. I think this one goes here. But I don't want to snap that in yet, just in case. Blower. Oh, I wonder if that's on the dash. That's a problem. Some of the wiring harness stays in the car. Some of the wiring harness leaves with the dash. Although, some of the Buicks and Mercedes and BMWs have them. That wiring harness is just a total mess. And you got your phone. It's ringing. Some of them it's a total mess and you gotta pull the entire wiring harness out of the whole dashboard and then try to remember where all the connectors go when it's out late. So at least with a Toyota, with half the harness staying in the dash, it's mostly gonna fall back in place. I still labeled it just in case. Anyway, some 10 millimeter bolts, we can go eat some lunch. Another once over, just in case. Then I'm gonna go eat. The gear wrench guy Dale was telling me that he knows a guy that works at Toyota that used to do these in 3 hours. That's impressive. If he had no leftover screws and did this in 3 hours, that's impressive. Because I'm at 4 hours now, and I'm going back together. I'm past halfway. It'll be another two and a half hours after lunch, I'm guessing. It'll be done today in one day, but I'm not seeing 3 hours. I mean, if I did another one, I'd probably be able to shave off an hour. But to do it in half the amount of time, I don't know. What do you guys think? Can you do this in 3 hours, or have you done them in 3 hours? I'm kind of interested. It's not a competition, but still, you like to know what the bar is. Who set the bar? All right, let's grab that metal brace. Pop that thing in there. This goes here. Now, all I need to do is remember where all the bolts go. Hey man, you got a potty mouth over there. I didn't say purdy mouth, it's a potty mouth.
Alright, let's all see a prayer.
That's why you can't tighten the bottom of these down, because they're slotted, so you gotta line everything else up first. I'm not gonna tighten any of these bolts until I get them all in loosely. I normally wouldn't do that because you don't want to forget one, but there's a lot of things that have to be kind of aligned, so you gotta have all your bolts in place first.
Not a lot of options when it comes to that.
Good.
Oh, that makes me sad.
I think the silver colored nuts, the one that ends, for some reason there's a difference in their strength or whatever structurally. So I'm going to swap out those gold ones for some of these. There's two silver ones on each side I kept. It's got to be because of that. I don't remember. Shall I go back and watch the video? There's a bolt down there and a bolt up here for the BCM, and since it's on a long stud that's welded, if they put a bolt in you could have just pulled this down a little bit and pulled it off, but because it's on a stud you got to take both bolts out to pull this away, and the PCM is trapped on the same bracket anyway. That's where the bottom of that goes, and the top of the PCM goes to this stud.
Internal grabbing check. I can get this bolt started, I know it. Wanna see what I'm doing?
You guys are kind of far away, man. I missed you. Bring you over here, we can hang out. Well, while I have you over here, by the way, the AC drain, I could have pulled it off the box here, but honestly, I forgot about it. I pulled the box out of the car and it just pulled the hose out of the floorboard. There's a rubber grommet that goes through down there, and make sure you put it back in place. You guys probably noticed that thing flopping around, but I never mentioned it until just now. ECM connectors. Let's get those back in there. Battery's still disconnected and all, so. These all go from the dash panel down. Same thing with these. Got my little Phillips screw in here. I tighten the main bolts for this now. I can tighten all these.
Uh-oh. Oh, battery's dead. That's terrible news. One side's buttoned up. Quick shifter. I think I did the shifter bracket.
Alright. Gotta get our little emergency brake return spring. It hooks on the pedal and on this little bracket. Fuse panel goes up. Ah, I hate when that happens. Get up here, will you? Stop horsing around. You got work to do. Double and triple checked all my connectors and anything I can get done to this stage. I'm gonna go get my dash pad and we'll be right back. I've looked over it and over it and over it as many times as I can. Make sure I didn't forget anything important like the spring and the braces and little bolt that goes on the side to the case and stuff. So, should be good to go. Let me stop procrastinating and go get it. The top just has pins.
You gotta line those pins up. There you go. Oh, that's nice.
That is nice.
I don't wanna let go of this until I get a couple bolts started.
Should be golden now, Jerry. Ground wire, radio wires, shifter wires, shifter and console, glove box, and I plug these bad Johnnies in here. Various assortment of connectors, BCM connectors, three connectors into the fuse panel, or accessory panel that is, I suppose. This is the big lead for the blower. A couple spare connectors. This is the one that was really weird coming apart. I had a hard time finding the tab. The release tab is not easy to get to. The last connector should be this actuator. There it is. All right. Now we're getting somewhere. All my little 10 millimeter bolts, there's quite a few of them. There's a nut and about, I guess, 9 or 10 millimeter bolts in the ground. Last screw in the glove box. This is the surround, not even the glove box retainer. It doesn't do anything. It's just a decorative piece that you have to remove to get to one screw for the airbag, which is a 12. I already tightened that one. Yeah, this is gonna be my glove box tensioner deal, hydraulic deal. And my pins, little plastic pins, hold the bottom. Oh, that's nice. Got my antenna hooked up. This goes this way. And hooks around the airbag. Pops back on the welded edge. Oh, spot welds. Man, I'm telling you guys, we're almost at new car status. We only got to deal with dun 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 dun. All that stuff. Got that all cleaned up best I can get it. There's some dust actually inside, but I'm not going to disassemble it. That'd be kind of silly. Two connectors. Make sure you get a nice click. I just thought to put the nut on the stud over here. Let's do that while I'm thinking about it. That was the 10 millimeter nut with a pretty big flange washer on it. Got my other bolt in. Got my nut on. Now I got a whole host of connectors to plug in. These are ones I labeled for the headlight panel. Don't have to worry about those. This is the ALDL. This goes to the steering column. Got to put my three Phillips screws and my trim in. We're on the home stretch, boys and girls. It's not gonna be long now. Not gonna be long at all. But you know what? I'm not ready to brag just yet because bad stuff happens. Oop, look at that. Speaking of bad stuff happening, don't forget your actuator. That would be terrible. You'd be like, why is the recirc not working? Did you plug them all in?
Yes, I think I did.
Some jobs I just prefer to do hand tools. Plastic being screwed into plastic is one of them. I could use my bit driver, but because I mean, it'll go real slow. But I just feel like I'm getting the perfect amount of tension without splitting the plastic and stuff when I do it by hand. Uh-oh, get over here. There you go. Doesn't work one way, try it the other. Got my repaired panel. Light panel. This is a blank accessory switch plug, but there's no switch there. I'm gonna put that surround on and then we're doing a steering column.
Is a tight squeeze, boys and girls.
It's designed for little Japanese men.
Three Phillips around the shifter, one down on the bottom on each side in the front, and two tens in the rear console compartment. Sometimes you gotta deal with food and money. You know, they kinda go together. Cigarette lighter, power outlet. Which one's which? I don't know. It says this one's supposed to be the lighter and this one's the power outlet. And versa vice. They look identical to me. Always make sure those trim panels are nice and flush all the way around. All these trim panels, double check them. Make sure everything's seated. All right, steering column. Now you gotta be careful. You don't want the steering column spinning. I had a bungee cord on there. I forgot to film it though, I apologize for that. But I put a bungee cord on the steering wheel around the shifter column, I mean the steering column, so that it wouldn't be able to roll around too much and get off center. Gotta get this back on my splines, lined up, hopefully. The four bolts that hold it in, that's the easy part. I think that's lined up pretty good. This bottom bolt's first. The upper bracket's spring-loaded, so I just get it to hold itself down here, so you don't have to support all the weight. Now I can reposition and get these bolts started. You get a little bit of an ab workout doing this too, because you're trying to hold yourself up off your tools and bolts and whatever else while you hold the steering column and start these bolts. There it goes. Now you could use a power tool to expedite the process and risk stripping it out, but you know how I feel about that. No need to go back to the gym. Got it covered right here. Holding about 25 pounds up for 10 minutes while you get the bolt started. Two bolts on the side. Ugh. Gotta unlock the steering column. One of those. And one of those. You know what that means. You guys know what that means, right? No screws left over. Yay! I even flipped the air filter around. The air filter was in wrong. You know, it has one corner and three rounded corners. And someone had it in backwards, so I had to blow it out and flip it over. The air filter box is missing a clip. That's probably why they couldn't get it closed with the air filter in wrong. So they just left the clip off instead of flipping the air filter over. I hate stuff like that. So simple. FYI, I used my hood prop to raise it higher because I smashed my head against this bug deflector and gave myself a little razor burn on my forehead. It sucks not having the built-in helmet that hair provides. Especially when you lead with your head. Alright, this thing's full. Pulled a really nice 30-inch vacuum. Just pinned the needle right down at the bottom so I know there's no leaks. Which, I mean, if you guys remember, it didn't have a low freon problem. Anyway, but my work is what I was checking. Let's start this thing up, see how it runs. Had to get the AC on here. Hey, stop it, wipers. Stereo works, that's good news. Doesn't sound good, but it works. AC. AC on. Blower's working. AC's not because the engine stalled. Must have lost the idle memory. These Toyotas that do idle memory, you either got to put it in gear with the emergency brake on and it wheel chocks, or you got to hold the gas pedal to keep it running for a few minutes and then just let it idle for like 30 minutes and it'll relearn to idle. They're pretty finicky. But good news is air is nice and cold, blown out of the correct locations. Fan speeds work. I'm gonna let this thing run a little bit, try to relearn the idle. Then we can take it for a drive. Oh, I gotta top the coolant off too. Probably lost a cup or so of coolant with the heater core out. And reset the clock. Change the washer fluid level sensor. It's got a pump and a level sensor separate. Try to get that washer fluid light out. And the washer fluid level light is no more. New car. You can buy this vehicle now for the low price of $34,995. or just get a new one for $55,000. It's up to you. Oh man, just want to take one last look at my quarter panel. This thing's done. I'm gonna grab the tailgate and start working on that next. And I got a couple little patches to do. The other quarter panel I have a wheel well patch for, but I don't have the front section to fix the bed mount area. This piece here, I'm still missing it for the other side. I haven't gotten it from Tucker's truck or Brother's trucks. I really appreciate you guys spending the day with me. I hope you'll torque the like button and maybe subscribe. You guys are awesome. I'll see you in the next video.